I'm Ron Millar, the political and PAC coordinator for the Center for Free Thought Equality, which is the advocacy and political arm of the American Humanist Association. My pronouns are he, him, his, and I'm calling from the lands of the Anacostan and Piscataway nations. So what does it mean to be the advocacy and political arm of the American Humanist Association? As a nonprofit, AHA is limited in what it can do in the political and electoral arenas. To remedy this, the Center for Free Thought Equality was formed in 2004. The Center for Free Thought Equality is a different type of nonprofit, which is allowed to lobby elected officials as its primary mission. Rachel Deitch will be talking with you about those activities shortly. The Center for Free Thought Equality, unlike other nonprofits, can also have a membership political action committee. This PAC, or our PAC, is the Free Thought Equality Fund, and we can endorse and provide financial support to candidates. As a membership PAC, only our members, those who sign up for the Center for Free Thought Equality, can be informed about the activities of the PAC. This federal PAC was formed in 2013. So I urge you to become a member of the Center for Free Thought Equality, and our huge selling point, in addition to getting to know about the work that we do, is that membership is absolutely free because we want to really encourage folks to get involved in the political process. So please join. So the three organizations give us all the tools necessary to increase our community's political clout: education, advocacy, and elections. And we do this work to advance evidence-based public policy, preserve the secular nature of our government, promote social justice, and to get a seat at the table for our community. We really, you know, you're just asking before, when will we have an atheist president? It's when the atheist and humanist community organize and become a powerful constituency, and that's how we get an atheist president. So now you might not be very familiar with the Center for Free Thought Equality, but you might know about our accomplishments. We were instrumental in having Congressman Jared Huffman announce that he is a humanist and agnostic. He's the only public non-theist member of Congress. This came about because in 2017, he returned a candidate questionnaire to our PAC with an intriguing response about how he identified with regard to religion. This followed with an email exchange to introduce ourselves and explore the topic. And the email messages finally culminated in a dinner invitation with the Congressman, Roy Speckhart, and myself. So at dinner, we discussed the goals of our movement and the need for elected officials to publicly identify with our community. After his announcement, as discussed before, Huffman received a great deal of positive feedback from his constituents and colleagues. And in fact, he received such positive feedback from his colleagues up on Capitol Hill that he decided to form a caucus. This was one of the ideas we had discussed with him at dinner. Huffman arranged an organizing meeting at his townhouse, and Roy and I, we were the only civilians there, the others were members of Congress. We met and discussed the idea of a caucus, and you know, everyone was excited to move forward. After the meeting, we held another meeting at the American Humanist Association headquarters, and we got the necessary paperwork together, and the Congressional Free Thought Caucus was born. And Rachel will be discussing the caucus in more detail a little later, but it's a membership group of Congress, and its goals are to foster science and evidence-based public policy, and it also provides a forum for members of Congress to learn about the atheist and humanist movement. Our last major accomplishment is that we've identified over 50 state legislators who are members of the atheist and humanist community and are willing to be public about it. This is up from just 5 prior to the 2016 elections. So we often like the hype that was over a 900% increase, and that sounds great, but the sad fact is we need another 1,500 or so state legislators to reach parity with our population. So we still have a lot of work to do. And just to demonstrate the magnitude of what's necessary, I have a little illustration here. You know, when you include you know, the nuns from the Pew research, it's about a quarter of the American population. However, in the bottom circle, you can see the thin blue line that represents our percentage of elected officials. This is about 2/3 of 1% of the total federal and state elected officials. So we've got a lot of work to do to reach parity with our population. And we're only going to do that if you guys get involved, we need you to be part of that work. We have resources on our website to help make your voice heard, engage your group, and to run for office. So please delve into these websites and determine how you can become more involved in the political process. You know, we often hear the message that this is the most important election in modern history and how crucial it is for everyone to vote. This is particularly true for the atheist and humanist community. In 2018, the religiously unaffiliated comprised 17% of all voters. Even though this was up from 15% in 2016 and 12% in 2014, we are voting far below our proportion of the population. We should be in the mid-20s. So please vote and make sure all your like-minded family, friends, and colleagues vote too. This is the year our community must turn out and vote. If this election does not motivate our community to participate, then I fear nothing will, and we can be deservedly blamed for an unfavorable outcome. With the pandemic, it's more important than ever that you make a plan to vote. This is not going to be your regular election. Take advantage of absentee and early voting. In fact, take advantage of absentee voting early, because with the attacks on the post office, it might get messy towards election day. So get your absentees as soon as you can and get them turned in as soon as you can. And it's going to vary by state and localities too. So if you decide to vote in person, make sure that you know where to vote. Recruiting poll workers for the general election may be difficult in the pandemic and force some localities to consolidate polling sites. So please don't miss your opportunity to make your voice heard in the general election. It's going to be complicated. Also, there's so much more you can do than just vote. Visit our website again to learn the ways you and your local organization can become more engaged in the electoral and political process. When you visit our website, I'll hype it again, please become a member of the Center for Free Thought Equality. I've heard that the membership is free, so join up. I really appreciate your participation and listening to me. As members of our community become more politically engaged and organized, we will empower our movement and increase our political clout. Our active political engagement will help promote science, evidence-based public policy to effectively address issues that confront us, like climate change and the pandemic. Our active engagement will also increase the visibility of the atheist and humanist community and help diminish the lingering bias against our community. And just to talk about that for a second, we did a poll with voters in 2018, because I had a conversation that year with a guy in West Texas, and he said, I can't possibly come out as an atheist. He said, I lose 2/3 of my constituents just by putting the D next to my name, and then more by being pro-choice and more by being LGBTQ friendly. And I was thinking, well, who else have you have to lose if you're going to call yourself an atheist? I mean, I think you've lost everybody. So we commissioned a poll to figure that out. And it does indeed, most people are more concerned about your policy stances than your religion. And the bias is still there. You could lose 10 to 14% of the population based on, whether you identify as an atheist, an agnostic, or some other term. But then we also found that 10 to 14% are going to be more excited about your campaign by using those identifiers. So again, please be engaged. We've got to increase our visibility. So if that's not enough of a reason to become more politically engaged, just consider that your active participation in the political process will help counter the white Christian nationalists and bring their bigoted, anti-science, racist, misogynistic, and homophobic crusade to an end. Now, personally, this is my motivation that gets me to work every day, so I hope it might encourage a few of you. With that, I'll urge you again to become a member of the Center for Free Thought Equality. It's free. And turn the program over to my colleague, Rachel Deitch, who is the Director for Policy and Social Justice. Hey, Rachel.
So hi, everyone. As Ron mentioned, my name is Rachel Deitch. My pronouns are she, her, hers, and I'm in the Occupy Territory, just like Ron, the Piscataway, and the Nakhochitang people. I'm also the Director of Policy and Social Justice at the Center for Free Thought Equality in the American Humanist Association. I'm essentially our organization's lobbyist. I became our lobbyist a year ago, and I'm going to stick to what I know and focus on how we've been building influence on the Hill in the last year. So Hamid already actually talked about the caucus and stole one of my slides, which I love. I want to see their faces everywhere. So I switched around my presentation last minute to show you some of the actions that the caucus has taken in the last year or two. And along with what's written here, I was really trying to get this together quickly. More recently, they've called on the State Department and the Nigerian government to protect the rights of Mubarak Bala, the president of the Nigerian Humanist Association, who was arrested more than 100 days ago for insulting religion. And they also sent a letter to Pompeo, put out a statement about Pompeo's newest Commission on Inalienable Rights report, affirming that, you know, we really need to be protecting the rights of all abroad and not just looking at the Bible and the Constitution for understanding where our human rights come from. So the caucus has four objectives, the last of which I'm going to skip through in the interest of time, is to provide a forum for members of Congress to discuss their moral frameworks, ethical values, and personal religious journeys. In terms of building influence, that last priority is key. Christian members of Congress have weekly Bible studies where they get together and talk about how their faith guides their policymaking. This builds influence. Well, the CFC is doing that for our community. The caucus has an agnostic humanist Jew, a Buddhist, a Hindu, and they're coming together and talking about their moral frameworks. And the more formalized spaces there are for these conversations, the more we can chip away at stigma, some of what Hemet was talking about. Additionally, we're building influence by being in meetings with these folks and their staff, and we're being seen as resources here. So often I walk into a congressional office, hi, my name's Rachel, I'm with the CFE and the AHA, and I really want you to sponsor this bill. But the caucus and our relationship with all the members of the caucus is a lot more balanced. Sorry, everyone. Got stuff in the way. They're looking for support from each other and from the free thought community on tackling issues. Got to figure out how to move this. So moving away from some of the folks who are clearly already champions, who we already have relationships with, I want to present a snapshot of how we're building influence. And to do that clearly, I'm going to use a more extreme example. How might we build influence with those in power who normally fight against us? What would that look like? So Senator Lankford of Oklahoma would probably be the last person many of us think of when it comes to voicing support for the rights of the non-religious. This quote on the screen is from a widely distributed press release about international religious freedom, wherein he also specifically calls out the rights of secularists. And this slide could actually be replaced with something even more recent. On Thursday, Lankford was on the floor of the Senate talking about international religious freedom and explicitly mentioned our community again. But this didn't just happen, right? Atheists don't just get included, humanists don't just get included in the talking points of very conservative senators. And I want to just flag before I move on that this quote isn't the end game. I'm not giving myself a gold star for a press release. But in terms of chipping away at stigma and building relationships, it's important to flag that quotes like these are becoming more common. And I want to talk about how we got here and what comes next. My background is in social justice aligned advocacy and coalition building. And there are some social justice tactics that we need to be applying across our work. First, follow the lead of impacted communities. Seems like a no-brainer. When we're trying to problem solve, taking our cues from those experiencing the brunt of the problem is not only good sense, but also how we enter right relationship with marginalized groups. And ultimately, this approach builds our network. It puts me as our lobbyist in relationship with other organizations that we might not have worked with in the past, who might not know what humanists are or why non-theists have a particular stake in what's going on. And then on the other end of that, we have to leverage our resources to show that we're serious. We can talk the talk, but until we follow our words with actions, we're not getting anything done. And I think sometimes we underestimate the importance of coalition building when it comes to building influence. These are ridiculously helpful in not only getting stuff done and responding to the barrage of attacks coming out of this administration, but also in building strong relationships that translate into influence. A quick example is our participation in Small Lobby for Reproductive Justice that Planned Parenthood's national office leads. By being in the room for every meeting, offering up resources, offering up my time, folks started to get to know us and get a better understanding of humanism. And I started getting asked, hey, can you come to a meeting on the Hill with me to talk about why this is a separation of religion and government issue? Oh, I know you're planning a panel on this. I think I have someone who'd be really good and would bring a new audience to your work. This is all increasing our visibility and helping people connect the dots on why we care about the issues we care about. We have broad coalitions like the Coalition Against Religious Discrimination that we're a part of, but we also have hyper-specific or issue-specific coalitions like the Anti-Blasphemy Coalition that we lead. Now, for folks who aren't familiar, and I guess I'll just say we're going to be on the slide for a while in case you really want to read all these, but it's not important. Don't get bogged down. For folks who aren't familiar, blasphemy laws around the world are laws that criminalize blasphemous speech or actions. They most often target religious minorities, the non-religious, women, LGBTQ people, and political dissidents. There are more than 80 countries that we know of that still have blasphemy laws on their books. And a week after I started as our lobbyist, I got a call from Representative Raskin's office. Hey, Rachel, I know AHA has been pushing for us to reintroduce the blasphemy resolution. We're ready. And the blasphemy resolution essentially calls for the end of global blasphemy, apostasy, and heresy laws. So I took a deep breath, and then I hit the ground running. I set up more than 30 meetings on the Hill in my first month. And for this resolution, I knew that if we wanted to get it moving, we really needed Republican support. It was important for Raskin's office that we do what we call Noah's Arking resolution, which is one Republican to one Democrat. And if we really wanted to get it moving, we had to do that. But when I started with these meetings, I had so much trouble getting Republican support. I'd get in front of a Republican staffer at a meeting and it just wouldn't go anywhere. It was basically laughably slow. So after 2 weeks, I stopped spinning my wheels and I asked, who are the other impacted communities? How can I build a stronger coalition? And I noticed that we had around 30 organizations peripherally supporting our blasphemy work. And I had a hunch that we could grow that and rely on them more than we had been previously. I started being more engaged in the International Religious Freedom Roundtable, where I was showing up every week to these meetings, providing AHA resources, to issues that perhaps weren't my number one priority. People started to know that they could count on AHA, and frankly, a lot of conservative members of this coalition started to think differently about humanists and myself personally as a non-theist. And because of that, our blasphemy coalition number is approaching 70, and that's the list you see on the left-hand side. And numbers matter here. It speaks to our ability to organize effectively and to the mission. And after I redirected my efforts away from the Hill towards civil society organizations like the ones listed here, it was like a flip switched. Within this list of supportive organizations are a handful of groups that have joined me in the more than 100 advocacy meetings we've taken on this issue. And these groups have been really helpful and instrumental in opening doors. We've been having productive meetings with people who could really give the resolution a bump, where I was talking about how blasphemy laws impact humanists and non-theists. I was walking into meetings not being coy about who I represent, which would be highly unethical. I was being unapologetically humanist and personally a non-theist and talking about how non-religious people are impacted by these laws. And I'm able to do that and be taken seriously because I'm also in the room with Christians and Muslims and Jews who are facing the same issues around the world. And that's the value of a broad coalition, which gets us a seat at the table. And if you want to groan about that pun, you can blame Ron. So because of our hard work leading this diverse coalition, we built a bipartisan sponsorship list, which ultimately led to a hearing on international religious persecution in the House. And AHA was one of four witnesses to testify in front of Congress about the harm of blasphemy laws. That's huge for our community. It was the first time AHA has ever testified before Congress. It was also my first time and a learning experience to be sure. And the hearing was actually the hard part, I kind of say. I don't want to jinx it. After that, our resolution was passed out of committee in March with full bipartisan support, and we're looking forward to seeing it pass the House this year. And it's because of all of this, our coalition building, the hundreds of meetings, and delivering on our work, that humanists and non-theists are taken seriously in international religious freedom spaces. And if there's time, I have a great anecdote about that. So this quote from Langford is meaningful. A staunchly conservative Christian Republican is on the record saying he supports the rights of non-religious people because we've been meeting with Langford staff regularly in our coalition work, and we got him to introduce the resolution in the Senate back in December. And on Thursday, Langford actually took the blasphemy resolution to the floor of the Senate and tried to pass it, which demonstrates his commitment to this issue. It didn't work this time, but I am undeterred. I like to say I'm pleasantly persistent. I have more meetings scheduled for Monday with Senate offices to talk about how we can get this done. However much, though, we can work with Senator Lankford on this particular issue, I didn't want to end on that because most of our work is actually focused on domestic progressive issues that we firmly disagree with Mr. Lankford on. This talk was about how we could build influence, which is why I thought that was a prime example, but I want to take a quick second to talk about our other work. And I'm happy to answer questions on this and our social justice work, which you saw a quick video of right before we started. In the time of COVID, we're doing a lot to uplift human dignity and good governance that adheres to separation of religion and government. I'm going to flag briefly that we and the Latinx Humanist Alliance are working with the ACLU to ensure that the next COVID relief package from Congress provides testing and treatment for all people in the United States, regardless of immigration status. And when we think of evidence-based policy, I actually was talking to a Senate chief the other day, who compared the gaps in our public health response to having a peeing section in a swimming pool. And that's totally accurate, except for the fact that people are not dying these days because of urine in pools. So if you want to help us with this work, I encourage you to visit our Humanist Action headquarters and reach out to your senators. With that, I am going to stop sharing. I think that worked. And turn to some questions. So I think the first question, I'm going to give myself a quick break and ask about who's in the Freethought Caucus. So that is a great question. I could throw up that slide. Perhaps that's better answered in the chat, however. So right now there's 12 or 13 members of the caucus, everyone from Pocan and Huffman and Raskin, Kasten, I feel like I could do this off the top of my head, Holmes, Norton, Johnson, folks from all over the place, Jayapal, Wild. Ron, who am I missing off the top of my head? Oh, Ron, you're muted. Can someone help us unmute Ron?
Ron, just click the little microphone at the bottom of your, there you go.
I'm unmuted now. It told me earlier that I wasn't allowed. I am horrible with listing everyone there.
Zoe Lofgren, yes, absolutely. Let me think on that and I'll put a list.
Yeah, we can. That.
So I'll go to another question from Lori Lippman Brown. I may have missed this, but how many members does CFE currently have?
We have about 2,000 active members. To be an active member with CFE, according to the regs by the FEC, you have to renew every year. So we have fun little things where we send out emails just to get people to respond back and stay an active member. So we have a larger list, but still it's a small, larger list. I think we only have like 6,000-7,000 names, but a little over 2,000 are active. Like I said before, we've got to grow this if we want to have the political clout to enable having a presidential candidate in the future. We need to grow it even to get more congressional candidates. So, and we are having a meeting tomorrow, just so you know, for members of the Center for Freethought Equality, which will go into things more detail because we can actually talk about candidates and fun things there. So if you join today, I'll get a message out to you tonight on how you can join that meeting.
Great. Next question comes from Jeffrey Bloom. Isn't it difficult to build coalitions with people who say they support freedom of religion, even for those with no religion? And then, like Senator Lankford, they write a letter to the Secretary of the Navy forcing the Navy to reject the appointment of a humanist chaplain. And there's a growing tendency of religious fundamentalists to claim they want freedom of religion, but they also now claim the free exercise clause does not apply to those with no religion, such as atheists and humanists. Do you have at some point to confront them about this hypocrisy? And I will say, absolutely. While I'm not talking with Senator Lankford directly about the hypocrisy of that, I have developed relationships with his staff, right? And I am able to say, hey, I saw this. This is terrible for our community and we're gonna fight against this. I think a lot of the work that we do in coalitions. I think actually coalition work in general, right? We're part of coalitions with 400, 500 different organizations, and not every organization agrees on every issue. We really work from an opt-in perspective where we come to the table agreeing about one thing, and then we have a whole bunch of discussions often about where we disagree and why we disagree. And I, at least, have been very vocal on the part of AHA. I think I would really be concerned about why we're involved in this work if we're not also trying to push folks and speak out against folks that we disagree with. Being the progressive organization or a progressive organization in a room so often with very conservative Christian organizations can be a challenge, but I'd much rather be in that room pushing back and calling out that hypocrisy when I see it than not be participating. Ron, any thoughts on your end?
I have a very timely question for you. Well, John Holmes asks, is there an entity that scores politicians based on their voting relative to humanist issues?
That is such a good question. I am so glad that has been asked. I was going to announce this tomorrow at the CFE membership meeting. And again, if you want to be a member of CFE, we encourage you to sign up ahead of that meeting. The CFE tomorrow is going to launch its congressional scorecard. We've been working on it all summer. And every Congress, CFE scores the House of Representatives on the votes they've taken, the way they've sponsored issues, and frankly, some of their caucus memberships. And we will be releasing that report tomorrow. And you will be able to see that on CFE's website.
And we have past Congresses already scored there too.
Yes.